A very good afternoon and a warm welcome to students, teachers and everyone who are present online for the lecture program today organized by Birla Industrial and Technological Museum under National Council of Science Museums on the occasion of International Day of Scientific Culture. Today's lecture is the part of BITM's age-old effort of introducing the students community with the stalwarts of scientific world. Carrying forward with this legacy, Dr. Jayanta Sthanapati, our guest speaker today, has chosen Michael Faraday and the dawn of electrical age as the topic of his lecture. I shall now request Sri V.S. Ramachandran, Director Birla Industrial and Technological Museum, to kindly introduce the speaker and set the stage for Dr. Sthanapati. Just to remind our viewers, if anyone has any relevant questions, please post the same in the chat box during the lecture. At the end of the lecture session, the speaker may select some of them and answer for you. Thank you.
Every year, September 28 is observed as International Day of Scientific Culture throughout the world. This year, Birla Industrial and Technological Museum is happy to have a distinguished person to talk on this occasion, none other than Dr. Jayanta Sthanapati. Dr. Jayanta Sthanapati started his service career in BITM under National Council of Science Museum, Government of India, as a curator in 1978. He served the NCSM for 33 long years and held the position of Director Headquarters, Director Birla Industrial and Technological Museum and Deputy Director General NCSM. He had earned a PhD degree, dual PhD he has got, PhD in science and also he has got a PhD in arts. Dr. Sthanapati had also worked in the history of science projects as a research associate and as a project investigator under the sponsorship of Indian National Science Academy, INSA. He had over 50 publications to his credit. We are extremely happy to have such a distinguished personality to talk on the topic Michael Faraday and the dawn of electric age. I welcome you, sir, on behalf of Birla Industrial and Technological Museum. The floor is yours. Thank you.
Hello viewers, on the International Day of Scientific Culture 2021, I present before you the story of Michael Faraday and his ingenious inventions of electric motor and electric generator that ushered the dawn of electrical age in the 19th century Europe. As already announced, it is a popular lecture and I have structured it for the general audience irrespective of their academic background. We have selected the topic of the presentation and its occasion for two specific reasons. Firstly, exactly 200 years ago in September 1821, Michael Faraday converted electrical energy into mechanical energy and thus created the world's first electric motor. And secondly, the work of Michael Faraday and the few other European and American scientists in electricity between 1791 and 1831 were the significant outcomes of the prevalent scientific culture in those countries. Since the beginning of civilization, culture is a way of life. Academicians broadly divide culture into three major categories. One, cultural concepts such as beliefs, values, and styles. Two, cultural behavior such as languages, gestures, customs, and foods. And three, cultural products like literature, art, music, and handcrafts. Like culture, scientific culture is an essential component of a civilized society. In a scientifically cultured society, scientists play the key role. And they are supported by scientific societies, science research institutions, and the like. The connotations of scientific culture include free exploration, seeking truth from facts, and striving for feasibility. We shall focus our attention today on the progress of electrical technology between 1791 and 1831 and show how scientific culture had played a significant role in such phenomenal development. Before moving on to the PowerPoint presentation, I express my gratitude to Sri V.S. Ramachandran, Director BITM, for giving me this opportunity to deliver a popular talk. I begin my lecture by drawing your attention to the cover of a book titled Michael Faraday and the Electrical Century, published in 2004. Its author, Professor Ivan Rhys Morris, is a renowned historian of 19th century science, medicine, and technology. Professor Morris, in his book, considered Michael Faraday as the central figure of all discoveries and inventions on electricity in the 19th century that transformed everyday life. Today, I shall focus on the dawn of electrical age, covering the period from 1791 to 1831, with Michael Faraday as the hero. I shall elaborate on Faraday's two most significant contributions, namely the electromagnetic rotor, or the first electric motor, and the electromagnetic induction experiments, or the first electric generator. Michael Faraday was born on the 22nd of September 1791 to a relatively low-income family in the country village of Newington, Butts of Surrey, within Greater London. He was the third child of James Faraday, a blacksmith, and Margaret Faraday, a homemaker. Michael received minimal schooling and did not show any spark of talent then. He used to spend out-of-school hours at home or playing games with the neighboring children. In 1804, at the age of 13, Michael joined George Ribot, a bookseller and stationer on Blandford Street in London, as an errand boy. After a year of his trial, he apprenticed under Ribot in bookbinding for 7 years. Whilst an apprentice, Michael loved to read the scientific books under his hands, such as Conversations on Chemistry, Experiments on Electricity, and many more. He also did simple experiments, chemical experiments, and constructed a statical electrical machine at Ribot's shop. Michael had a turning point in his life in 1812. Mr. Dance, a regular customer of Ribot's shop and a member of the Royal Institution of London, arranged Michael's invitation to hear 4 lectures of Sir Humphrey Davy, a noted scientist at the institution. Faraday made notes, then wrote out the lectures in fuller forms, interspersing them with appropriate drawings. His desire was to be engaged in a scientific occupation. even though of the lowest kind. So by late 1812, he took a bold step of writing to Sir Humphry Davy, expressing his desire for scientific employment. A reply came from Davy, who offered him a position of assistant in the Royal Institution's laboratory. And thus Faraday began his scientific career at the Royal Institution in March 1813 as a laboratory assistant. From October 1813 to April 1815, Davy traveled to various European countries to meet leading scientists and see their laboratories. He took Faraday with him to assist in experiments and in writing. The exposure enabled Michael to update his knowledge in contemporary scientific developments. Faraday began active research in chemistry at the Royal Institution in 1816. His publications in scientific journals increased every year. 6 in 1817, 11 in 1818, and 19 in 1819. In 1780, Louis Galvani, an Italian physician and professor of anatomy, discovered that a dead frog's dissected leg hung from a brass hook twitched when touched with a metal knife. After repeating the experiment a few more times, he concluded that the frog's muscles generated a new kind of electricity. He announced his fantastic discovery of animal electricity in 1791. In 1792, Alessandro Volta, an Italian professor of physics, conducted several experiments in line with Galvani. He realized that the crucial component of the investigation was the two different metals, the brass hook and the knife of some other metal, connected momentarily by dead frog muscle. He opined that these dissimilar metals had created electric current and the frog's leg just conducted electricity. In 1800, Alessandro Volta created a continuous source of electricity when he placed a moist material between two dissimilar metals. And thus, Volta invented the world's first electric battery, later named Volta's pile. The schematic diagram on the left is an example of a voltaic pile or a battery having 8 identical cells connected in series that produced 8 times a voltage V. Each cell consists of a copper disc and a zinc disc separated by a moist material soaked in an electrolyte. On the right, we have shown an image of an original voltaic pile displayed in a museum. In 1820, Hans Christian Oersted, a Danish physicist, discovered the connection between electricity and magnetism. On 21st April, during a classroom demonstration, he observed that an electric current in a straight wire caused a nearby magnetic compass needle to orient itself perpendicular to the wire. We will discuss his findings with the help of schematic diagrams. The magnetic compass is placed on a stable platform
and there is no second magnet kept nearby. As such, the compass needle aligns itself with the horizontal component of the Earth's magnetic field. An electrical conducting wire AB having no electrical supply from a battery was placed above the compass needle as shown in figure A. The compass needle continued to remain in the same state, pointing towards the same direction. Now, without making any change to the positions of the wire AB and the compass needle, a battery, a voltaic pile, was connected to the wire. The needle deflected, as shown in figure B. If he reversed the current flow in the wire by changing the battery's polarity, the compass needle deflected in the opposite direction, as shown in figure C. On 21st July 1820, Oersted published his experimental observations in a pamphlet and circulated them to scientific societies and select scientists in Europe. Although qualitative, his studies had undoubtedly proved that electricity and magnetism, hitherto believed as distinct phenomena, were closely related. It marked the beginning of the subsequent discovery of several phenomena of electromagnetism in the 19th century Europe and America. On 11th September 1820, Dominique Arago, a French scientist, demonstrated Oersted's experiment before the galaxy of contemporary scientists at the Academy of Science in Paris. Only after 7 days, on 18th September 1820, André-Marie Ampère, a French physicist and mathematician, presented his extended work on electromagnetism at the same Academy of Sciences. Ampère created magnetic attraction and repulsion without magnets. He exhibited that two parallel wires carrying electric current in the same direction attracted each other. Furthermore, they repelled each other if the electric currents in the wires moved in opposite directions. The adjacent drawings depict his findings graphically. Soon after hearing of the finding of Oersted that electric current could create a magnetic field, several researchers attempted to develop devices to measure the flow of electric current. Please look at the images from left to right. In each of the three images, you will notice that the magnetic needle is placed at the center of a coil of current-carrying wire. In 1820, Johann Schweigger in the University of Halle in Germany developed a galvanic multiplier. Then in 1821, Johann Poggendorf at the University of Berlin in Germany designed a galvanomagnetic condenser. And in 1821, James Cumming of University of Cambridge in England developed a galvanoscope. These three devices are the forerunner of the galvanometer developed in 1825 by Leopoldo Nobili of the Royal Museum of Physics and Natural History, Florence, in Italy. Michael Faraday began his fundamental research in electromagnetism at the Royal Institution in early 1821. Let me describe how it happened. Richard Phillips, the editor of the Annals of Philosophy, had requested Faraday to write a comprehensive account on electromagnetism for his journal. Faraday, until that time, was involved only in chemical research, but he accepted Richard's request. However, to gain a thorough understanding of the subject, Faraday repeated all the experiments conducted by others in various parts of Europe by that time. Finally, he completed his account titled Historical Sketch of Electromagnetism. The Annals of Philosophy published it in its July, August, and September issues in 1821. In September 1821, Faraday created a continuous rotation of a current-carrying wire around a magnetic pole. Thus, at the age of 30, Faraday became internationally famous for creating the electric motor. Let us see, how did he do so? He first investigated with a bar magnet and a straight electrical wire. He kept the wire vertically upright and passed a current through it using a voltaic pile. He then brought one end of the bar held horizontally close to the wire and noticed its reflection. I have not shown it in the slide. In the subsequent arrangement, he bent the wire to form a crank, as in figure A. When he passed the current through the wire, he noticed the wire's rotary motion. The direction of rotation changed with the direction of flow of current in the wire. The motion, however, was interrupted due to the physical presence of the bar magnet. The discovery of the rotation effect excited Faraday immensely. In his diary, he wrote, on 3rd September 1821, "Very satisfactory, but make more sensible apparatus." Within the next few days, he designed and created an apparatus to exhibit continuous electromagnetic rotation, as in figure B. In his device, a steep wire, which was a part of the electrical circuit, hung down with its lower end dipped in a mercury pool in a glass vessel. A bar magnet was fixed upright at the bottom of the container, and its other end protruded slightly above the mercury level. As soon as he connected the voltaic pile to the circuit, the stiff wire created a magnetic field around it. That field interacted with the bar magnet's magnetic field, and as a result, the wire rotated continuously around the magnet. We have described here the operation of Faraday's electromagnetic double rotator. It is also called Faraday's mercury bath. Faraday made the schematic drawing himself. While on the left side, a free magnet M1 rotated around the fixed wire W1, the free wire W2 revolved around the fixed magnet M2 on the right side of the apparatus. A photograph of Faraday's apparatus is also shown here. The original is on display at the Royal Institution, London.
Faraday's rotation experiment. Michael Faraday showed that a magnet is capable of producing a rotational motion in a conductor carrying current. This can be demonstrated by an experimental setup similar to that used by Faraday. Take a white glass tube with corks fitted at both ends. Now insert a bar magnet NS into the tube in such a way that the north pole of the magnet is inside the tube. Place some small amount of mercury inside the tube. See that the north pole is above the meniscus of mercury. Take two copper wires and insert free ends of the copper wires from lower and upper ends of the tube. Observe that the end of the copper wire that is inserted from above is bent to form a hook. The copper wire which is fixed at the lower end of the tube is in contact with mercury. Suspend a copper wire from the hook. Complete the circuit using a battery, rheostat and key. What do you observe? We observe that the copper wire which is suspended from the hook revolves around the north pole. Now switch off the current. The copper wire stops revolving around the north pole. This indicates that a freely suspended current carrying conductor rotates round the magnet because the magnet exerts some force on it.
Faraday designed this. There's a wire that goes into a pool of mercury to which a magnet is attached. And when you pass a current through that wire, watch what happens. Believe it or not, this is the world's first electric motor. 10 years passed, and with proof that magnetism and electricity could drive motion, Faraday made an incredible intellectual leap.
We will now describe two cases of failures to perceive electromagnetic induction. In 1825, Dominique Franquès Arago in France discovered a mysterious effect then called magnetism of rotation or magnetism from rotation. In the experiment, he hanged a magnetic needle with the help of a torsionless thread just above a circular copper disc. A belt pulley mechanism could rotate the disc. He noticed the turning of the disc affected the needle to turn in the same direction. If the disc's rate of rotation was rapid enough, the magnetic needle rotated continuously. In London, Charles Babbage and John Herschel soon noticed the same phenomena as Arago, but by conducting a reverse experiment. They revolved a horizontally kept copper disc pivoted at the center by spinning a magnet placed underneath. They all then believed that some form of magnetism had developed in the electrically conductant non-magnetic material due to a nearby magnet's motion. In the later part of this presentation, we will show that Michael Faraday in 1831 suspected that the rotation of the magnet had induced electric current in the disc, which in turn had created a magnetic field that interacted with the magnetic needle or the magnet. Here we show a modified version of Arago's experiment. Jean Daniel Collodion, a Swedish engineer in 1825, had narrowly missed discovery of electromagnetic induction. He took a strongly magnetized steel bar A, a coil of copper wire B, and a galvanometer G. He connected the coil's open ends to the galvanometer. He expected that the introduction of the magnetized bar in the coil, as shown in the image, would create induced electricity and in turn would move the galvanometer needle. Collodion, in order to avoid the bar magnet's direct influence on the galvanometer's magnetic needle, kept the galvanometer in an adjacent room and connected it to the coil by using long pair of wires. Collodion inserted the magnet into the coil, left it there, and then moved to the adjacent room to check if the galvanometer had moved or not. He did not observe any deflection of the galvanometer needle. 6 years later, Michael Faraday's similar experimentation showed that such electromagnetic induction is transitory. Collodion could have watched a deflection of the needle had he kept the galvanometer within his sight. Michael Faraday in London, with the help of three different experiments conducted during August and October 1831, had succeeded in observing electromagnetic induction, or in other words, in producing electricity from magnetism. Faraday recorded a description of the first successful investigation in his diary on 29 August 1831 under the heading Experiments on the Production of Electricity from Magnetism. He made a continuous ring from soft iron of 6 inches of external diameter using a 7/8 inch diameter rod. He wound two sets of insulated copper wires on the ring, as shown in the simplified graphics. While one coil, we call it primary coil, was connected to a battery through an off-on key, the other coil, the secondary, was connected to a galvanometer through a pair of long lead wires. Faraday noticed deflection in the galvanometer needle immediately on passing an electric current through the primary coil, but by closing the key. The needle oscillated for a while and then settled in its original position. On disconnection of the electric supply to the primary coil, the needle deflected again, but in the opposite direction. Joseph Henry, a professor of mathematics and natural philosophy at the University of Albany in the United States of America, in 1831 started a series of experiments in electromagnetism with a primary aim to produce electricity from magnetism. Henry's experimental setup was almost similar to that of Faraday's first experiment. While Faraday had used a soft iron core ring, Henry used a soft iron bar over which he wound primary and secondary coils of insulated copper wires. He passed electricity from a battery through the primary coil and it activated the electromagnet. The magnetic field thus produced had immediately induced current of electricity in the secondary coil surrounding the electromagnet, and in turn deflected the needle of the galvanometer, but returned to its original position soon. The needle deflected in the opposite direction as soon as the current in the primary coils was ceased. In Henry's words, it was electricity converted into magnetism, and then magnetism into electricity. Henry reported his successful experimentation on the production of electricity from magnetism in the American Journal of Science and Arts in 1832. For this reason, both Faraday and Henry are credited as co-discoverers of electromagnetic induction. On 17 October 1831, Faraday conducted his second successful experiment to create electricity from magnetism. We are presenting here a set of three simplified graphics to describe the phenomena. He had a bar magnet and a helical coil made out of 220 feet long wire connected to a galvanometer. As soon as he thrust the magnet into the coil, the galvanometer needle moved. When he pulled it out, the needle moved in the opposite direction. The needle returned to the center of the galvanometer when the magnet was stationary. The magnet's pushing and pulling in the coil produced a wave of electricity because of electromagnetic induction.
South pole. On this magnet, the North Pole is painted red and the South Pole is the clear color. Now, what I'm going to do is take the North Pole, the red, South Pole. On this magnet, the North Pole is painted red and the South Pole is the clear color. Now, what I'm going to do is take the North Pole, the red, push it in, and notice that the needle moves to the right. When I pull the North Pole out, the needle moves to the left. North Pole in, North Pole out. Watch what happens if I use the South Pole. South Pole in, South Pole out, we have the opposite effect. South makes it move to the left. When I come out, it moves to the right. North Pole moving in, moves to the right. When I come out, moves to the left. To generate alternating current, we simply move the magnet back and forth periodically.
The master stroke came from Michael Faraday on 28th October 1831, when he constructed a new electrical machine to produce electricity continuously. In a previous slide, we have described the mysterious effect called magnetism from rotation discovered by Francois Arago and subsequently observed by Charles Babbage and William Herschel in 1825. 6 years later, in October 31, Faraday realized that the creation of electricity in the rotating non-magnetic disk in the presence of the magnetic field was due to electromagnetic induction. He thus got a clue to construct a new electricity generator. Faraday's disk dynamo was a machine for continuously converting rotational mechanical energy into electrical energy. The apparatus consisted of a copper disk D of 12 inches diameter and 1/5 inch thickness. The disk with a brass axle was mounted vertically on a frame and rotated freely by turning the attached handle. Two slip contacts, one at the center and the other at the periphery of the disc, were connected electrically to a galvanometer through two posts B and B dash. A large compound horseshoe-shaped permanent magnet, A, was positioned in such a way so that the disc could revolve between its poles freely. On rotating the disc, Faraday noticed a deflection in the galvanometer. Further, the direction of the deflection reversed with the reversal of the direction of the rotation. In this video, we see a copper disc free to rotate vertically. It can be rotated clockwise or anti-clockwise by using a handle. A galvanometer is connected to the disc at its center and its periphery by two slip contacts. The plate's rotation does not produce electricity to move the needle of the meter. However, when the disc is placed between the poles of a strong magnet, a horseshoe magnet, we see the effects Faraday has discovered in 1831. We definitely can say that true scientific culture in select European countries and the USA enabled phenomenal progress of electrical technology between 1791 and 1831. And it is needless to say that Michael Faraday contributed a lot to this process. So, what were the reasons for Faraday's success? Let us elaborate. Michael Faraday's adage always was work, finish, publish. He invariably repeated experiments done by others before him. He understood the underlying principle in his way. He then conceptualized something new, and he did a series of experiments until reaching his goal. He always recorded details of his investigations in his diary. He also conveyed his success stories to the scientific world quickly through publications. Thank you.
Thank you for the very, very lucid and illuminating lecture. I find that a lot of schools participated and few questions are streaming in. Shall I repeat some questions or you have the questions?
Okay, let me, Mr. Seel, let me give a brief account covering all the questions. And then I will go through the questions if anything extra is to be said.
Okay.
So first of all, I thank the viewers who have put up questions, but I find there are very few relevant questions. So instead of answering each question, I will first make some general comments, which is not covered in the presentation. You see, the Michael Faraday was a devoted researcher that we have established at the Royal Institutions, and he held positions of laboratory assistant from 1813 to 1825. But even being a laboratory assistant, he did world-shaking discoveries. He was director of the laboratory from 1825 to till his demise in 1867, and was a Fullerian professor of chemistry from 1833 to 1867. His discoveries include electromagnetic induction, which we have covered today, liquefaction of gas. He is the first to liquefy gas. We know, like liquid nitrogen, liquid oxygen, all these things. He liquefied chlorine gas, benzene. Then electromagnetic induction we have discussed today. Laws of electrolysis in 1833. After that, magneto-optical effect in 1845, and diamagnetism again in 1845. Now, already, as already explained, we have focused today on his electromagnetic rotation and electromagnetic induction experiment for obvious reason, because we were covering the subject of dawn of electrical age. Now, we need to keep in mind that the detailed explanations of the discoveries of Faraday, Oersted, Ampere, Arago, Collodion, Henry, everything came after they did the actual experiment, many years after that. And the explanations which we find in the standard books or in internet are all done after the discoveries they have made. So this is very significant that without knowing much about the theory behind, they went on and discovered one after the other. In fact, this was a scientific culture, as today's topic is scientific culture. A scientific culture in Europe and some part of America, where research institutions were set up, research societies were set up, and they supported immensely to individual researchers. The researchers might be not in high position, in a very low paid position, but even then, because of their dedication, they did a lot of work. Now here, some explanations which we got later on. You see, Ampere's swimming rule, we have read in the book. This explains the direction of movement of the magnetic north pole of the compass needle in Oersted's experiment. Initially, it was not there. Then we have Fleming's right-hand thumb rule, which shows why Ampere's two parallel wires, if the current is in the same direction, they attract each other. And when in opposite, they repel each other. So Ampere's right-hand thumb rule is there. And further, Lange's law explains the electromagnetic induction very clearly. One thing which is very important is, if Faraday, even after doing the discovery of electromagnetic induction, he didn't sit idle. In the next year, what he did, he thought that if a river flows and the river's water can carry electric current, or it is a conducting fluid, he considered river water is a conducting fluid. So why not we see the effect of magnetic field on a conducting fluid? So he thought that the Earth's magnetic field will definitely work on a flowing river's flowing water, which is a conductor. He did an experiment in 1832 to check whether there is any potential difference between two banks of the river water. Unfortunately, he didn't find anything because the instruments available at that time were not so sensitive. And many years after this failure, in 1942, the magnetohydrodynamics was discovered. Okay, so this is an inspiring character for us. And I think I have covered most of the questions which are there. And so thank you very much, BITM, the director, Mr. V.S. Ramachandran, Mr. Gautam Shil, the compeer, and all the students and the viewers for giving patient hearing to my lecture. Thank you so much.